back to Callahan's Corner, where you ask the questions, we answer them live right here on Facebook. So had a question that was submitted on the Facebook group. I'm going to actually pull my phone up here and read it. But feeling for this gentleman, I have been there before. But basically, to put some context, this gentleman has left his business for 8 weeks because of some medical issues and came back to a little less than pretty much a disaster on his hands. So definitely not here preaching on a pedestal by any means. I have been here. And it's part of the reason why you can see some of the magazine articles behind me in Lawn and Landscape Magazine, where I like to share on Callahan's Corner of the magazine and Snow Magazine some of the trials and tribulations we've been through, some of the things we got lucky enough to get right, and, well, some of the things similar to this gentleman's question we didn't get right off the bat. So a little context, my lawn care business and snow removal business, Upper Northeast in upstate New York, 25 years, obviously from the early years through high school, through college, well up to 19 or 20 crews plowing before we exited through acquisition. So I definitely can speak to this candidly, but I think that this hits home whether you are not planning to be out of the mix on a day-to-day basis, or you actually want to be more of the Michael Gerber work on it, not in it, or you just want to leave for 3-4 weeks or at least 10 days for a vacation and not come back to an utter disaster, you know, in your business. So what I'm going to do is read this question, and then I'm actually going to flip the screen open and give you some ideas of how to actually tackle this, or at least lay some foundational pieces of this. So Tom writes in here, I come into work at 6 a.m. for the first time in 8 weeks. My wife has been coming in for me due to a surgery. So first of all, Tom, kudos to your wife. If you haven't, give her a big kiss and say thanks and take her out to a really nice dinner, because most people's spouses would not go into their service business to have their back for 8 weeks. So you've done well there for sure. But what he finds out is I find the backside of his deck, his V2 ride, is all effed up and is unusable. His Skag Cheetah mower sounds, well, less than desirable. I'm going to clean out some of the additives here. And is bone dry of oil. Numerous pieces of two-stick equipment are not running. Just problems. At least the end of the season is 6 weeks away. So Tom, I'm feeling for you here, brother. We've all been there, and we've been through, I don't know, maybe 6 or 7 people who actually ran my business when I actually left and finally became an absentee owner. But these are things that not only if your wife's helping you, but if you are going to leave for a few days or a vacation or anything like that, or you got the unexpected. And let's face it, guys and girls here. I enjoyed my time on the truck, but there was a point at that business that I was in a very risky situation. If I blew out a knee or hurt my back or something like that and couldn't go into the shop every day, that business probably would have crumbled or at least seen some of the issues that Tom's seeing here. So what I'm going to do is pop my screen open here and show you kind of what we're looking at. So this is a form that we used right in my business. We called it a KPI. Lawn mowing daily job costing report, or basically it was just really, it was a touch base of what was going on. So the premise was the company manager, whoever was bringing these folks in, was ultimately responsible for the things that were set in play for the crews. So the operations manager would go in and fill this form out in their mobile phone. The product we use was Service Autopilot, but I don't care if you're using a Google form, pen and paper, whatever it is. There's some key items that I'd recommend checking it out. So we've got the name of the person completing the form, the date, and the address of the shop, which shop they were at. This came into play sometimes with snow removal if we had pieces of equipment scattered across the city. And if you're looking into how we did that, check out Lawn and Landscape Magazine or Snow Magazine. We broke that down as well. But the next thing is they listed the crew leader, and the crew leader's start and stop time from the shop. So was the crew leader on time? Was the crew leader... when did they leave? So now we got some accountability. Who is the crew technician? When did they start and stop? We ran 2-man crews on all of our setups. Fertilizing was 1 person. So this was a setup particular to us, but if you have more crew leaders, you could put that in there. Highly recommend sticking to 2-person crew. 3-man crew gets a little wonky unless you're doing very big commercial with minimal drive time. Now we've got our quality control manager, if any, and our quality control manager start and stop times. If they went out in the field and were doing training, or something actually producing production. Otherwise, the gentleman or lady who'd fill this out up here is the actual manager. They are responsible for these things ultimately, and it goes up that chain of command. Now, the crew is going to have their own form clocking in and out of all the jobs in an area at the end of the day to fill out a form if things needed attention. But what we're doing is putting the start and stop time at the shop so we know what their payroll start and stop for a double check. The budgeted hours for the day. So how many hours did we give that crew to do the work, including drive time? What was their actual? So we're creating accountability for that production manager, whoever's getting them out in the morning and at night, to have a conversation with them. Did you hit your budgeted times with a quality control? And then eventually the next morning, that would be put up on a big dry erase board for accountability for everybody. Total sales for the crew. So how many dollars per hour? So if we had 10 hours and we had $1,000 of sales for that mowing crew, we would take the 20 hours and divide that into the 1,000 hours or the $1,000 and have a dollar per man hour rate. Now, as we evolved, this form got a little more complex where we would do actual versus budgeted production man hours or dollar per man hour grossing. Oil check for equipment. Tom, writing his thing, said, hey, came back in and the mowers are bone dry. Well, Tom, I can't tell you until we started doing something like this, and there's different renditions of this, I can't tell you how many engines we blew. So we went in and then we created an automated process for equipment and asset management. But this is a piece of form that before we got to the automated equipment and asset management for tracking repairs and reoccurring maintenance preventative, this was something we did on paper and then on a form, and then we automated it. Then, so they're filling this out for each crew. End of each end of the day overview and completion. So did we have the gas receipts done? So we didn't have gas at our shop, but literally 30 seconds down the road, we had a gas station right there. So it was easier for us to have someone come in the beginning of the day before everybody got there, gas the equipment up, load the trucks, and do a spot check on all the equipment based on what came out here. So are the gas receipts attached? Once again, in the mobile phone, you take a quick snapshot of it. It's there attached to the form. Total gas expense per crew. Route sheets scanned or attached. So basically at that point in service autopilot, they're clocking in and out of the mobiles. But if there was ever a case where we had an issue in the office, we couldn't get them printed, or I mean couldn't get them in the mobile, occasionally we'd have one printed out. So we would scan that through a mobile app and attach it to the form. So everything was one solid place. Equipment condition and pictures. Confirm the assigned or loaner equipment is present and conditioned. So we would go in and state the two weed whackers, two blowers, maybe a stick edger. What's going on? Are they present? And take pictures of them. So we have a walking audit trail of what those look like. So just like Tom said, all his handheld equipment was destroyed. Well, we could figure out where it happened and when it happened, because we had accountability. So even if you're laid up in bed, you could sweep through all this in 2 to 3 minutes a day and know exactly what's going on. Equipment that needs repair and pictures. So before we automated that process, we would go in and have them fill out a manual tag on the piece of equipment, put it in the area of the shop where we hung the broken equipment, and they confirm whether the assigned equipment or loaner equipment need a repair and take a picture of it, and we'd have an electronic versus a hard copy on the actual equipment. So we've got to check some balances. So our full-time mechanic that came in at night would have basically a work order waiting for him. And then daily notes. So include all the employees that were late or no show, enter the details, employ it, and fill it in on their employee record and service autopilot it well. And then where it says choose files, you could upload it from a laptop or I recommend using a mobile, and it's all in one. But Tom, this is the foundational pieces when we had the same exact thing that you're going through right now to start building. So yes, there may be 6 weeks left in the season, but what I'm guessing is you may want to, eventually take your wife out to a little vacation there, a nice dinner, and not have to worry about the phone ringing and things being chaotic. So in order for us to work on it and not in it like Michael Gerber, or potentially become an absentee owner of 30 days at a pop like I did in my business. Now that was only 4 weeks. Obviously he's had 8 weeks here. These are some of the foundational things I recommend building in the business for accountability. And then we start building on them, but we need to have the accountability for the crew, ultimately landing on the crew leader. And then as you scale your business, we've got a production manager, business manager that is also accountable. So we've got checks and balances. So that manager is checking with the crews, making them accountable. And then the manager is reporting it out to the business owner. And that seemed to basically alleviate the issues you got going on here. Now, as a business scales, I recommend somebody coming in at the end of the day after everybody left or before everybody comes in, loading those trucks, checking the oil, doing an internal check, and then have the crews do a double check on that. That redundancy is going to save you that $3,000 to $4,000 engine with equipment and labor on it. So comments or questions, drop below Callahan's Corner. You drop the questions here and we answer them live right on Facebook. We'll see you again tomorrow, Callahan's Corner. But Tom, hang in there, man. Been there, done that a few times. It's easier than it looks here. You just need to really just start it out on pen and paper or a form and then automate it eventually. But those are the kind of steps that we took, and building clarity and accountability to it was the key to success. And obviously none of us know when we're going to go down for 6 to 8 weeks hurt. These things happen. So it, even if you think this could never happen to me, it's not if, but when. So this is the time right now, if you're thinking about it, block off an hour or two tonight or over the week and start piecing together either a form online or even a hard copy form until you get that automated and electronic on a mobile. So comments, questions, drop below Callahan's Corner. You ask the questions, we answer them live right on Facebook.